on, everybody. Thanks so much for coming out, and thanks for your patience. If you haven't been here before, this is Nat and Image Hall. I would say that we do events like this 2 to 3 times a week, but that may discount just how exceptional tonight's program is, both in terms of the novel by Ingeborg Bachmann and Werner Schroeter's adaptation, and really just how thankful we are to have Sarah Nicole Prickett and Rachel Kushner here to situate these works. Without further ado, I'll give the floor to Sarah Nicole Prickett. Thank you guys so much for coming.
Hi. I have nothing to hold in my hands because the papers that I brought with me I left in the car. So, sorry. The movie you're about to see is a movie where a woman, and I don't know if this is a trigger warning or a spoiler alert, dies. And...
Spoiler.
Okay. You know, I feel like same difference.
I don't.
And thank you for letting me know. And I love movies. I love Isabelle Huppert, who's really one of the only actresses who could play someone who was sort of like the titular woman, although the woman doesn't have a name or a title, in Ingeborg Bachmann's novel, Malina, which I read, of course, because Rachel told me to read it. It is indeed the best thing I've read about being a woman in a very long time. Ingeborg Bachmann, in addition to being a woman, was a feminist. It's a common misperception that a work of art about being a woman is inherently feminist. But this one is, and her life's work is feminist to the precise degree, I would say, that it's anti-fascist. So, of course, it's a very modern novel. I mean, it was written literally yesterday, like in the 70s. And the film was written by Elfriede Jelinek, also a feminist novelist, who tried to write the film the way that she thought Ingeborg Bachmann would have written it had she lived another 20 years through another cycle of gains and losses. And when the film came out, there was some disagreement about whether this goal had been achieved, because as we see the manner in which the woman dies, if you've read the novel, it's not like in the novel. The script, he was much closer to the way the novel ends, and is very subtle. You wonder at the end of it whether this woman was a figment of your imagination, because she disappears, you know, into a crack, like a physical crack. But of course you can make it very figurative, and you can say that's about the way that female geniuses slip between the cracks of history, or whatever you like. The movie is something very different. And so at the time, feminist critics thought that it was murder, which is the last line of the novel, but it was murder of a different kind. It was the murder of like the project that the novel represented. You can make up your own mind. I would read to you from Jelinek's screenplay, the script, which was not the script that was eventually shot for the film, but I don't have it with me. You can Google it. It's online. Isabelle Huppert. You know, everyone else, American actors, the great actors, Meryl Streep or whoever, they all act in like a frenzy of justification. You know, you see them on screen and they're like, how did I get here? What am I thinking about? What is my favorite color? What did my mother say to me that I never forgot? Isabelle Huppert doesn't do any of those things. She's just like pure response. She doesn't exist, nothing, there's nothing outside of the frame. It's like maybe because they teach existentialism in school or something, but I don't mean to suggest that this is some kind of like Brechtian epic drama, just that it's an amazing thing to experience her acting in a film where she's probably the auteur, no offense to Schroeter, because she's just it. She's it in the same way that Ingeborg Bachmann, when she was writing this novel, was it when she disappears in the end. Maybe it's not because she dies, it's just because the novel is over. She's like successfully become one with the book. It ends, she's gone, that's it. It's a theory. Like The Sopranos. Okay, here's Rachel.
Thanks. That was great. I'm not used to this kind of room and just speaking without a microphone, but I guess that would be egregious. I wouldn't really need one. Just say a few words first about Malina, the novel, and then I have a little short text I was going to read. I read Malina for the first time over maybe almost 3 decades ago. I was a young woman and had a very strong response to this novel, and then New Directions, bless them, said they wanted to reprint it because it's been out of print for a long time. Would I want to write the preface? And I immediately answered, like, yes, absolutely, I want to do it. And I reread it. I hadn't read it in a long time, and it's a very abstract book. And when I first reread it, I overconfidently thought, you know, I'll know exactly what to say because I had such a strong relationship to this book when I was young. When I read it, at first, it was like trying to read the label of a food can that had lost its label. I just kept like turning it in my hands. Like I was unable to find a way in. Because for like the first 100 pages, it's not quite clear what she's doing. But then it's a book that gives rewards in manifold ways. As soon as you click into it, it becomes so intimate because it's written with a form that is equal to the intelligence of this woman rather than a compromised or degraded form that we know of generally as the novel. Maybe I'll say that. So it's a book I really love, and then I actually had never seen this movie. I like Werner Schroeter. I know his movie Maria Malibran pretty well. Has anybody seen Maria Malibran? It's a great movie. Anyway, I had never seen this movie. And I sent a note to a friend who happens to be married to Isabelle Huppert, who stars in it. And I said, hey, I'm gonna be introducing a screening of Malina. Like, just wanted to let you know. And he didn't write me back. That's cool. Like, they're probably busy. They're probably like in Greece or something, right? And my phone rang this morning at 7:30, and it was Isabelle Huppert. And I'm not lying. And she said, her husband's name is Ronnie. He is a guy I know. I've never met her. I do not know her. And she said, Ronnie told me that there will be a screening tonight in LA of Malina. And she said, where is it showing? And I couldn't remember the name of this place. It was like, I've been gone a lot, and I didn't know it was here. I'm happy to have discovered it. I will be back. But I said, it's a new theater in Highland Park. And she was like, well, what is it called? I couldn't remember. Anyway, she was very excited about the screening. And she told me a bunch of things about being in this film. And I quickly scribbled them down and thought I'd just share them with you. That's cool. Just things about her. But I have to use this lamp because I need to be able to see. Okay. I just wrote it down in her voice. So just remember, this isn't me speaking. It's actually Isabelle Huppert, which I know it's easy to make the, you know, to confuse us a little bit. This film was one of my best souvenirs as an actress, by which, of course, she meant memory. In fact, she said, it may have been my best souvenir. Meaning in her the entirety of her acting career. Werner was a poet and a genius. This was my discovery of Bachmann. Although I read first the script, which had been written, as Sarah pointed out, by Elfriede Jelinek. I immediately admired Bachmann, and I wish I would have known her. So extravagant and funny. Truly a woman's woman. Recently, I did readings with the artist Anselm Kiefer of her poetry, and some of the letters that she and her lover Paul Celan wrote to each other. Making Malina, every single thing about the production was unusual, due to Werner. So often poetry and movies do not go together. But Werner made a film that was as abstract and poetic as this novel. He was a true Baroque and a great filmmaker. He always wore a huge black hat and rings on all his fingers. I had complete confidence in him. He was an extraordinary person and a great inspiration to Fassbinder and Daniel Schmid. I was eager to work with him. Fassbinder had talked about what an inspiration Werner was to him, as he was to many others. Foucault, for instance, saw Maria Malibran and reached out to Werner, wanting to become friends. A big part of the filming of Malina was fire, actual fire and its destructive work, but also fire as a metaphor. Everything we did on the set was so physical, but it was also as if the entire thing was a dream and the action a form of dreaming. We filmed in Munich, Genoa, and Bad Ischl, which is a spa town in Austria that features thermal baths and huge caves, absolutely enormous caves. The set was so visual, like limitlessly extravagant, and yet it had a very precise tonal direction, specificity. The music was sung by a Greek soprano, and we had music on the set the entire time while we were shooting the scenes. There was so much joy. We went out every night and drank gallons of wine. There was a scene where I was meant to be drunk, and so I was actually drunk, very drunk. You will see. There was a scene where I was supposed to walk on fire. I was so scared to do it. Werner, to demonstrate to me that I would be okay, volunteered to do the scene first, so he walked on fire. He walked on it, so I felt I could do it. It hurt, but not as badly as I thought it would. This was barefoot? I asked on the phone this morning, and Isabelle said, "Of course!" At the end of the film, he had planned to keep shooting, but he would have burned up the entire film set, and the firemen who were standing by decided at the end of the film for Werner, instead of Werner, because of the danger. "This is the end of your film," they said. "You have to stop now." Werner would have burned up everything. He was a person without limits. Elfriede Jelinek came to the set while we were filming. She was incredibly kind. I never saw her again. She did not come at all while I was shooting The Piano Teacher by Michael Haneke, based on her novel, but she came to the set of Malina. I feel I'm very lucky to be cross-pollinated by Ingeborg Bachmann, Elfriede Jelinek, and Werner Schroeter, three high figures of poetic arts. It was such a blessed time in my life to make this movie. I made another film with Werner in 2002 called Two. If he had lived longer, we would have made many more films together. He wanted me to play an Austrian king, Frederick II of Prussia. That was going to be my big role. He and I had one final time together in Frankfurt when there was a retrospective of all of Werner's films. He was ill, and he knew he was going to die, but he was very happy to have his work celebrated. It was the last time I ever saw him. The death of Werner Schroeter, for me, was the death of the ultimate dandy. So that's that. Let's watch.